with the Washington Outsider Report on the Coalition Radio. For those newly joining the show, my name is Irina Zuckerman, and I'm the editor-in-chief of the Washington Outsider. With us today is the MIT professor, Dr. Yossi Sheffi. He is the author of a new book, The Magic Conveyor Belt, Supply Chains, AI, and the Future of Work. And he's also the director of the MIT Center for Transportation and Logistics. What that means, we'll find out in a second. But this topic is more than relevant in light of everything that's going on, the supply chain disruptions across the country, more international issues with supply chains as well. Several factors have impacted these concerns, the energy crisis, the war in Ukraine, and of course, before that, the pandemic. We'll find out how that works and whether the new scientific and technological developments will improve the situation or add another layer of complexity. Dr. Sheffi, thank you and welcome to the Washington Outsider Report.
Nice to be here and thank you for having me.
Before we delve into the book, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, how you got involved in this area, and what is the relationship between engineering and logistics, and what does the Center for Transportation and Logistics actually do?
Okay, so the center just celebrated its 50th year at MIT. It's an interdepartmental center. I have people from all branches of engineering and management and urban planning, what have you, working in the center. It's the main activity is dealing with various aspects of transportation, logistics, and supply chain management. So we have in the center, we have basically four main activities. Education, we give master degrees and PhD degrees. It's a only graduate program. We have, of course, research, and I'll come back to it in a minute, on multiple projects. We have a program of a relationship with industry. We call it the Supply Chain Exchange. We have over 50 companies who are members and work with us all the time. And the last part is we have an international program, which we call SCALE, the Supply Chain and Logistics Excellence Network. We open 5 centers around the world, in Colombia, Spain, Luxembourg, China, and Malaysia. And we're now negotiating another one in the Middle East. And they are basically started as a copy of us. And we are helping them to build, it's like a logistics academy, basically, an independent center locally that does research in logistics, work with local industry, and teaches logistics at the supply chain management at the graduate level. Projects here range from anything you can think of, just basic understanding of logistics, various elements of supply chain management, procurement, inventory planning, distribution, what have you, warehousing, to specific projects like on humanitarian logistics, we have a project on the shortage of drivers in transportation, trying to predict when drivers will leave the profession using AI, try to predict it. We have projects in a very large project in Mexico with tens of thousands of small businesses. They fail very frequently, and we try to make sure to understand how they can stay in business, basically, and give them tools that are appropriate for small businesses to do the ordering, the inventory planning, the distribution, all of this. And we have projects on resilience. Even before the pandemic, my first book in 2005 was called The Resilient Enterprise. Even at that book, I was talking about the fact that the U.S. doesn't have enough ventilators. If there'll be a pandemic, the U.S. doesn't have enough ventilators. Just as an example. We deal with many, many areas. We have a large part that deal with aging population and the process of aging, starting with driver aging. You know, how do you keep drivers on the road? But that now got into all aspects of aging. We have a project on autonomous vehicles. So I'm, you know, we have a large project on food supply chain, on how you keep, how you minimize food waste and how you get more efficiently from the farm to the table. So all kinds of many projects, dozens and dozens of projects, a project in how to run ports more efficiently with a large dose of AI, how to run warehouses with robotics. So all over the map, all kinds of projects.
Well, that sounds incredible. And yet I think when most people think of logistics and supply chains, to them it sounds like something mysterious, far away, rather than important in everyday aspects of their lives and quite frequently intertwined with various diverse industries and professions.
Yeah, we have the member of our supply chain exchange are from every industry, mm-hmm. because they all share the same problems in procurement, in inventory, in warehousing, in distribution. They all share the same problem in transport, in freight transportation, in using, you know, airplanes and ships and trucks and right. So it's actually, we mix a lot of industry. We're not along one vertical industry. Of course, during the pandemic, supply chain went from something that we all know about to something that the average citizen started with. Oh, that's important. How my stuff get from somewhere around the world to the supermarket or to Amazon warehouse? Well, it's complex and it can be disrupted and it's different. And how many stages it takes? Look, an Intel chip crosses the Pacific about six times before you put it into a computer in various stages of manufacturing. Every place adds something to the chip. So it's, you know, to get some, in the book, in the recent book, this my ninth book, the recent book tried to follow two items. One of them, banana, it goes to from Costa Rica to all the process it goes to until it gets to a supermarket, and a T-shirt that is done in somewhere in somewhere in Asia, and the number of companies that it has to go through, and the number of tax regime and the regulatory regime that it has to go through until it gets either to the warehouse, to the e-commerce warehouse, or to the store shelf. So, in fact, after the pandemic, this is what got me interested in writing this book, because after the pandemic, I was always working in this area, but people started asking, what is supply chain? Why did we have all these shortages? What happened? What's going on? So I wrote the original idea of the book was to write a simple explanation of what supply chain is. But then I wrote it, and then it's really different, because supply chain, we didn't call it supply chain, but 50, 60 years ago, it was about moving boxes and driving trucks. And now it's a very high technology area. So with managing complex networks all over the world in real time, so there's a lot of technology involved. So I started writing about the technology, and at the same time, generative AI came on the scene, ChatGPT, and then several others. So I tried to include this, my prediction of what will happen to jobs with the generative AI. So that's how the book includes a salad of things.
Before we get into that, I actually wanted to get back to your earlier book that you mentioned, which predicted the shortages that U.S. would experience in the case of a pandemic. And given that it was many years before anything actually happened, what was the process of assessing how much U.S. would need in such a scenario? And how would you even model something like that, given the response of the government would have been too early to tell at that point?
Yeah. It's really interesting. when Clinton was president, he started a whole big central inventory of gowns and masks, personal protective equipment. President Bush built it even higher, and President Obama let it go to almost nothing. And President Trump probably didn't even know it's there. But that's why we got to where we got. Sorry. Because, so the reason that President Clinton started it, he read a book about pandemics. And there are models of disease projection and pandemic projection. These are not a complicated model. You have the rate that people are infected, you multiply by the population, by the time you get, you know, the whole projection, you get how many people can get sick at the same time and how many people need treatment. So, and then you look at how many ventilators exist. I just look at ventilator. I didn't look at the mask and PPE. It was just an example for me because the book was about risk management and preparing for all kind of risks. Mainly, I was concerned actually not with the pandemic, with the ventilator, or with the medical supply. I was concerned mostly with the material and parts, things that go into products, supply chain management in general. But just as an example, said we're not ready for a lot of things. And one of the things we're not ready for a big pandemic. We don't have enough ventilators. It was a sideline. It wasn't like a chapter in the book. It was just a paragraph. I talk about a lot of things, and among other things, I mentioned this. So that's how it came about.
It's the whole thing is quite shocking because many of the people across the country who very much were in favor of listening to the experts apparently did not even read what the experts had to say, much less listen to them.
It's not even the expert. On the cover of Time magazine, 7 times. The cover of Time had a headline that said the incoming pandemic. The Time magazine, it's not a scientific book, it's Time magazine. Still people didn't realize. People don't like bad news. So it's, and there's something else. Since there's always probability or likelihood that may or may not happen, you have to invest money now in order to prepare. And what happens if it doesn't happen? You know, then you just wasted the money. But that's the whole difficulty with preparing for risks. You want to invest in something that, in fact, you hope you'll never use. You hope you'll never use the ability to be resilient and flexible and agile and move and change suppliers and, you know, as the situation develops. You hope you'll never, but you have to develop this ability, whether it's software or relationship or a lot of other things. So, it's inherently difficult for companies because the costs now are clear. The benefit may or may not happen.
So this area of figuring out exactly what you may need in the future, I guess it requires several types of different calculations, risk analysis, basically inventory planning. What else? What comes into the picture when you're trying to make that decision?
Okay, first of all, the idea that it is scientific and accurate is a fallacy. It's not. You're guessing at the future. There's an element of guessing. Now, you can do intelligent guessing based on trends and data, but at the end, let's admit it's guessing. And companies come to it in different ways. In addition to looking at the for example, companies do scenario planning. So they do all kind of possible scenario and try to see which scenario is more likely to happen in the future. Shell, the oil company, was very famous for doing this. And they predicted the oil embargo 1973 because they were looking at the indicator that we are leading there. For example, what could be indicator for a pandemic? Indicator for them could be that you look at what's happening in the wet markets in China and Indonesia and Vietnam and say, this is a problem. Or you can look at what the irresponsible actors are doing in the laboratories, you know, developing all kinds of things. This is, you know, disconcerting. Just like, for example, you know, the Union of Concerned Scientists has the doomsday clock that tried to look at the possibility of a nuclear attack. It's a guess. At the end, it's a guess. What you can do is something else. What you can do much better than guess what will happen. Yeah, you try to guess, you can do several things. You could try to see how to deal with it. So you can drill. You can say, okay, what happens if this is happened? How are we going to support this? How are we gonna... And companies have playbooks. If for certain kinds of disruptions or problems, they say, okay, if this happened, we do this. If this happened, now it never happens exactly the way it's in the book, but it helps. Companies also prepare what's called emergency management rooms. So it's one location where all the information, all the decision making is taking place in case of a disruption. So, for example, Walmart. Walmart know that every year there's a good chance there'll be big hurricanes in Florida. So it has a whole set of activities that it knows what to do if there's a big hurricane in Florida. And it's done right there at the emergency management center, because it could be Florida, it could be Louisiana, it could be Texas. They don't know where it's going to be and who's going to be affected. But they have a set of rules that worked in the past. They try to say, okay, what will people need? They'll need water, they'll need, I don't know, blankets, who knows? Depending on the type of disruption. I'm sorry, this just, my computer start ringing when this is taking place. So anyway, so I forgot my train of thought now.
You were saying how the companies are basically preparing scenarios with different types of playbooks for various...
Preparing scenarios, watching their suppliers to see how is their financial situation. Watching to see if there's some supplier that suddenly a supplier of important parts that they happen to make a product, and they try to say, okay, what happens if some executives are leaving, or they have problems of paying their own suppliers, or they're just trying to assess something going on somewhere around the world that can impact them. And that, without going into too many details, there are actually software that help them to do things like this.
So when you started writing a book, how did you figure out which scenarios to write about that would be understandable to the general public? What made you choose the banana and the t-shirt?
So these are not scenarios, these are examples. Mm-hmm. It's simply examples that I'm familiar with. Mm-hmm. That's all. It's example that an area that I tend to do a lot from my own experience. I interview a lot of companies, and either I'm consulting with them maybe on something, or work with them on some project related to this. So a lot of this is just my own. I do very little looking at what other people did and write and say, okay, I'll add to this or change this. I'll try to do what's called primary research. Mm-hmm. So I talk directly to companies and people who are involved. I base a lot of it on my work. So that's how I choose. And the examples have to fit, have to demonstrate something that I'm trying to say. So that's how I choose them.
You know, in recent years, I have come across a lot of discussions, articles, and basically analysis claiming that the end of globalization is coming due to isolationist sentiments, due to X, Y, Z factors. To me, it sounds like a lot of this is not easily reversible due to the complications. You know, the banana example is very simple, but even it requires a lot of international cooperation to get it from point A to B, or even to make the banana tree grow to begin with, from fertilizers to everything else. So if you're talking about something more complicated like machinery and sophisticated, complex technical products, it doesn't sound like it's something that is entirely self-sustaining in any particular country or region.
You are absolutely right. It is far more difficult than people think. Company, for example, most companies are talking about getting out of China. You know, China and the US, now there's tension and try to disassociate from China. This will take decades. It says companies invested already billions of dollars in decades in developing Chinese suppliers and Chinese plants and manufacturing site. They are very good. People here still think that the companies go to China because of low labor costs. No, most companies are in China because China has sophisticated suppliers and state-of-the-art, you know, machinery and plant. And it's not because of low cost. In fact, companies that went to China in low cost, like you know, cloth manufacturing, is now all done in Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. It's not, even Chinese companies are not in China. Now, the textile part, which is very sophisticated manufacturing process, is done in China because it required a big capital investment and sophisticated machinery. It's done in China, but the cutting and sewing with a lot of people is done in Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. So it's not easy to live. Second, there are many, many stages of production. And for example, in China, it's much easier to mine, to get stuff from the ground, because there are a lot less environmental law, not that strong. It's much harder in the United States or Europe. So how do you stop? So you may do the final assembly in the United States, but you still depend on the minerals that are coming from China. So it's not, getting out of China is not as simple. Now people are trying to regionalize but it will take time. And it's also, it will increase cost, increase inflation. It's because the minute that you don't have global sourcing and global market, you are reducing your scope and scale, which means you cannot divide the cost of research and development and all the fixed costs over so many products. So the products are becoming more expensive. So it's a lot of problems on the way, including, by the way, for example, TSMC, which is the largest semiconductor manufacturer in the world, is building a plant in the United States, but they said making chips in the United States will cost 50% more than making them in Taiwan. And the question is why? Because they say we don't have enough engineering talent in the United States that can make these chips. So we have to train them ourselves. It raises the cost. So there's so many things that people are not really taking into account when they say, you know, everything, it's not moving back to the United States. Now, some of it is moving to friendlier countries, to Mexico, to Canada for sure. Canada and the United States is actually one in that sense, but you know, to Europe, especially, you know, Western Europe. Okay, you can buy and sell easily from France, whether it's Eastern, Western Europe or Japan or South Korea, Australia. But it's not easy to live on the huge infrastructure that was built in China. It will take decades to replace. So as I always say, when everything's said and done, a lot is more said than done.
You know, when you mentioned this gap in engineering talent for all the investments into STEM education and encouraging people to pursue the track, this makes me look at the so-called knowledge economy also as a supply chain in itself. If you do not have a pipeline of people who have the necessary skills and motivation to pursue the skills, we would necessarily have to import the talent from somewhere else. And given the immigration system structure, that is also not so easy. So we are basically have ended up in a situation where we are underskilled and the knowledge economy then suffers, which may have an impact on all other types of supply chains, which at the end of the day are dependent on that sort of thing. So how do we overcome that gap, and how what would it take to generate sufficient knowledge resources to be able to regain self-sufficiency in that realm?
Okay, first of all, we have to several things. First of all, to have to refocus schools from, you know, age five to PhD in university on merit. Not try to do social engineering, but try to focus on the stuff that we need to learn and do, on the aim of schools and universities, impart knowledge and life knowledge, and knowledge on the stems, knowledge in general. But there are several other issues in the United States. We have too many people actually going to college. We should have many more trade school, because with a new AI-based machinery, we need a lot more operators, but sophisticated operator. It's not operator to just put a screw somewhere, but somebody who can operate a robot. So, and understand how the robot works. And furthermore, when the robot makes a mistake, understand the mistake and fix it, or take over from the robot, or stop the robot from working. So for this, you don't need to be a computer scientist for this. For example, you can drive a car. You don't need to know how to build a car in order to drive a car. You drive a car. Okay, you learn how to drive. Now, a lot of people know how to drive a car. It's simple, so you can learn from a lot. Driving a sophisticated robot is a little different. Okay, we understand. But it does not to be a high-level computer scientist for this. You don't need a PhD in computer science. In fact, you'll be frustrated if you have a PhD in computer science, because you like to write computer code and invent new things, not operate sophisticated machinery. So we need more people to go to trade school. I highlight in my book the German systems. The German system is a very interesting system. It's called dual education. After high school graduates, instead of going to university, 52% of German high school graduates go to the dual system. They work half time in a company and half time study in a university, but the same subjects, both the theory and actually how, doing it. It's a 3, usually 4 year program. And it's the way they do it, you apply to a university, and the university gets in touch with a local college with whom they have already agreement. The government funds part of it. So it's a partnership between the government, industry, and academia. And the government defined 350 or 360 professions where this is done, recognized profession. They're German, so of course everything is organized. And people are coming out of 70% of these people get hired by the company that they did their internship for. And even people who are not hired, but it's come out with experience. They now can work. So this is an example of a system, very different system. In the United States, every mother likes to be proud that her son or daughter went to university, got a bachelor degree or even graduate degree. But we end up with a lot of people owing a lot of money for a long time and not always getting the best education relevant education.
There seems to be a fairly simple solution to this problem, which is to call trade schools a type of university, a technical university, and exactly. The problem is solved. You issue
problem is solved. It's a little more complicated than that, but this is now you also have to realize that there's an issue of improving skills.
Sure.
As we introduce more and more technology. But on the other hand, we have so many more MOOCs, massive online courses. Many of them are basically for free that you can take and learn a lot of things. So people have to have the responsibility to upgrade themselves, to make sure they're not left behind. So it's another avenue for people to get into... if they're afraid they're going to lose the job is going to be automated, to learn related jobs that require maybe more use of technology or not, or just related jobs.
So this has been a subject of much controversy in the United States in particular in recent years, we had the situation where the coal miners were concerned about transition to renewable forms of energy, and then somebody, I don't remember who exactly, said, oh, well, we'll teach them coding. And then there was a huge outburst because of the non-transferable skills between coal mining and coding and so forth. So how do you manage this supply chain of skills to make sure that...
First of all, I agree with you that this was a stupid comment. Mm-hmm. Teach them coding was a stupid comment because they don't have the background for this for the most part. Mm-hmm. So unless they develop it at home at night, and you can do it, very few of them do. So now you have to, because they didn't have even their STEM education during high school was not usually not enough. So no, that's not gonna happen. But there are other jobs. Give you an example. There are jobs now in warehouses that you don't need to understand how the warehouse works. You wear glasses, it's a special glasses, and augmented reality, you see, you know, racks of packages. It lets you pick these packages. This what inside these packages is this, this, and this. Take it to this location, open the packages, took two items out of this, put it into the bin that is going out to the truck. It's all, you give instructions on the spot. You don't have to think about it. So technology can also simplify many of the jobs and allow people who are not coders, nothing to do with coding, to perform tasks that are, you know, that before require a lot more education, if you want, or train, not education, training. So you have all this, but let me also add that it's clear to me that the speed, the generative AI, the ChatGPT, and all these, all the other clones are coming and starting to get into the workplace is so fast that people cannot change fast enough, which means that the government right now has to make plans to support people while they upgrade the skill and change professions. And the government, and it will be, I would say, from 2 years from now, we have a period of 3-5 years, the government will have to put massive amount of money in supporting people while they upgrade and reskill. I hope somebody's thinking about it. I who knows? I think the government is just trying to, the Democrats hate the Republicans hate the Democrats. Aside from this, not much gets done, unless a catastrophe like the debt ceiling, and then everybody is afraid that they'll be blamed, so they do something. But I would say the working of the American government does not instill a lot of confidence that things can be done.
I have to say one positive example from another country that I think could be replicable either by the government or by private institutions. In El Salvador, they adopted cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, as a form of payment officially. But leaving aside the merits or demerits of that decision, what they also did in addition to doing that is built an education system for base users, for regular lay people, to learn how to actually do that. Now, I'm not saying that US should adopt cryptocurrency as its form, but in terms of new technologies, in terms of these new skills, it's relatively easy to facilitate that learning, either through private public partnerships or some other combinations, but I don't see any of that really happening anywhere. There's huge investment of generic donations into universities that most people cannot afford, but very little by way of these sort of semi-formal programs for steel building. It's separate from universities, as far as we see.
I'm not sure that the semi-problem will work in the United States, but the technical trade school, I think, would be something less than university, but more than high school,
mm-hmm.
based on some technology, is something that should be done, as well as support people while they upgrade themselves, whether they go to school, they change profession. For example, if somebody is a miner, wants he can change into a construction worker. But you have to teach, there's a period of time that you have to teach how to use, you know, all the big machinery that you use in construction. Okay, maybe the government will support a company that will take them as intern, and through internship for a year, they'll work without a salary paid by the government. The company will have a free workforce, a free worker, but this worker will learn the job. The thing is, people need to want to do it and think about how to do it. You're right, it can be done, but nothing in the United States is simple. Everything becomes political. If you suggest that the government will help people, it becomes, oh my God, we are communists. If you suggest that we'll help everybody, then the Republicans say we lose free will and we lose it. It always becomes political. So it's hard.
Unfortunately, which brings me to another point that's related and also related to your book, which is the role of AI and automation and the future of jobs, because I'm hearing from a lot of people a great deal of concern that automation will kill jobs. And indeed, some of the jobs, low-level jobs, such as supermarket vendors, they do, some of these jobs do become more automated. And some people were talking about minimum wage and how it was really the fault of a minimum wage, or other people are saying that it's irrelevant and would have happened anyway. But looking at history, we've had periods of rapid industrialization where indeed some jobs were lost, but that didn't mean that we faced massive and permanent unemployment. On the contrary, people did eventually transition to much better positions in life. Instead of driving buggies, we now have taxis. So the question is, how, to what extent are these concerns legitimate, and to what extent is this uncertainty from new breakthroughs, and how can it be managed?
Irina, the truth is that nobody knows.
Mm-hmm.
Some people think it's the end of the world, and some people think it's the new period of nirvana. So it's very hard. But when we don't know what's going to happen, we usually look at the past. And you're absolutely right. We're in the middle of the fifth industrial revolution. In every industrial revolution, there was huge technological changes, whether it's mechanization of looms in England, or electricity and steam power, electricity, railroad, airplanes, whatever. Huge technological innovation. And many more jobs were created than lost. Some jobs were lost, clearly. But many more jobs were created. Most jobs were not lost, or most jobs just changed because you got more machinery to help with the job. It is a little ridiculous to be totally afraid when the unemployment rate in the United States is now 3.5%. This is historical low, historical, unbelievably low. So doesn't look like we're losing too many jobs to all the new technology. Yeah, I know. I see headlines of Google and Amazon laying off people. These people will have no jobs. Maybe they're not going to have jobs will be a free barista that will make coffee whenever they want, but there will be jobs. In fact, traditional industry is swallowing these people like there's no tomorrow. But if you work for GM, you don't get free meals and, standby baristas, but you get a good salary. That's it. So all of these many millennials and Gen Zs will have to get used to the real world when nobody gives stuff to you for nothing. And this is maybe a little adjustment, but it's a healthy adjustment. So by and large, we still have huge shortage of workers. Still today, with all the development, all everything, there's still huge shortage of workers. And there's also another issue. Why all the anxiety? And I understand the anxiety. The anxiety is because there'll be many new industries and many new jobs that will be created. We just don't know what they are. We know the jobs that are going to be lost, because this, you can see that the job of the supermarket clerk you know, part of it is now automated. We don't need to go to the clerk. We can go to the machine and do it ourselves. Okay, so there'll be a lot less clerk. But there are two phenomena that are counter to this trend. First of all, you know, when the ATM machine became widely available, you know, the automatic teller machine, people thought there'll be no more tellers. In the late 70s, early 80s, when this machine became widespread, there were 300,000 tellers in the United States. You know how many tellers there are now? Over 600,000. Why? With the ATM. Why? Because as a result of ATM, it became a lot cheaper to open a bank branch. So I don't know about Washington, but in Boston and Main Street, every third store is a new bank branch because it became a lot cheaper to open them. So there are actually a lot more tellers. And then there's the issue of totally new industry. It's kind of things that you didn't think about. So Ford, for example, had a big technological breakthrough when they changed the process of making cars from expert going around the car to the assembly line, that the car moves along and people just do the same job over and over again. Because of this, so first of all, the number, a lot more cars were built, became cheaper to build cars. So the number of employees of Ford went from several thousand to 150,000 at the height of the Model T. But this was not the big change. The big change was that car became a lot less expensive. So the United States built highway and hotel and motel and restaurant. The whole hospitality industry developed with millions of jobs. And nobody predicted it. Now you think about it today, hey, it looks, you know, reasonable, but who would have predicted it? Who would have gotten ready for this? So, or, you know, the number of, you know, when you go on an airline, it used to be five people in the cockpit, two pilots, flight engineer, navigator, and communication specialist. Now there are only two because all the other jobs are automated. In fact, today, that's when people are getting really afraid that something will happen. There's something that will stop things from happening too quickly, and this is public acceptance. Would today a modern aircraft, being 787, 797, A350, any modern aircraft can go gate to gate without a pilot? Can taxi from the gate, go around, take off, fly, cross the Atlantic, land in Paris, no problem. Nobody, no human involved. Would you go on an airplane where there's no pilot on it? I don't think you will. And none of your listeners would, because we're used to it. We think we need it. And just to show you how things change, in 1945, 15,000 elevator operators in New York went on a strike. New York shut down. People did not get into the big office building. They were afraid to go to an elevator, even though they saw what the operator was doing. It was very simple. It was up and down and up and down. That's it. And opening the door. Anybody could do it, but they're afraid to do it. New York had to settle with the elevator operators and gave them a large salary increase in 1945. And then, of course, Otis came about 3 or 4 years later, came with the automatic elevator that anybody could operate, and then it took over. But it took a while. So if people are not going to be accepting, for example, big autonomous truck riding behind you on a highway with no driver, you know, think about it, you know, 50-ton truck with nobody in it going at 100 miles per hour behind you on the highway, it's disconcerting. So we have issue of society acceptance. We have, you know, labor unions that always slow down the adoption of technology. We have regulation that slow down the adoption of technology. So the last example, you know, we talk about the telephone operators. There used to be telephone operators, you know, women that were chucking the plug into the exchange. In 1892, AT&T invented the automatic telephone operator, the automatic telephone exchange. 1892. In 1950, there were still 350,000 operators in the United States. Only in 1980, it went away. 9 decades, 90 years it took from the invention until the position was actually gone. So it, things are not happening that fast, even though the software is moving very fast and distributed very fast. ChatGPT, you know, set records in how many people adopted, how fast it was adopted. Yeah, but it's adopted. People are playing with it, but it doesn't change jobs yet. We'll see. Finally, there's one very tough job that will become very common, and this is monitoring. Being able to monitor a system, being able to, and this is a tough job because you get to sit and not do much and just hope that the system doesn't do something crazy. And when it does something crazy, you have to disconnect it and start doing it yourself. So you have to know what to do. That's a tough job because something that you don't do all the time, it's hard to jump in and start doing suddenly. But we'll have to find a way to do this. We'll have to find how to keep people awake, how to keep people engaged, huh? So they can monitor an autonomous system, whether it's driving a truck or a robot doing something or a software in the background that does some operation. Or I tell my students, you can use ChatGPT. I don't care. You want to write an article with ChatGPT? Fine. But I read it as a human. I find a mistake, you get the F, not OpenAI, not the company that invested in ChatGPT. So yeah, you can use it, but it makes mistake. You should realize it. It invents it, there's hallucination, it invents stuff. But you have to know how to use it. It's just another tool. Anyway.
Speaking of ChatGPT, personal from reading some of these essays, well, some of them can be entertaining and occasionally useful for some specific things, for some routine research work where you don't, you know, where you just need to gather some information. When it comes to producing original content, there is no substitute for human ingenuity because each individual thinks in a unique way and you can't just pre-program. Then you definitely lose the element of surprise that comes with original thinking.
Just understand that ChatGPT and large language model and other AI learn in the same way that people learn. How do people learn? The people learn by watching the teacher, by looking at examples, looking at case study, looking at the mentoring work, by looking by examples. ChatGPT is trained on data. It just does it at a computer speed, not at a human speed.
Mm-hmm.
But it looks basically at what's in the data, in the training data. So it cannot come with somebody totally different. The reason that it's so good is because it trained on stuff that we wrote. So it looks human, but it can also make mistakes.
So that actually brings me to the point. While automation itself is one issue, obstacle and opportunity at the same time, the role of AI is causing even more debate because people don't really understand what it is and how it works, and it seems very mysterious. Automation people understand, they get the basic concept. With AI, there's a lot to iron out from the ethics perspective, from the applications perspective.
Irina, every technology at the beginning looks like magic. I mean, I think I'm older than you. When I was in school, we learned how to do square root by hand. Take a square root of any number by hand. Nobody teaches this anymore because they're calculators. Calculators look like magic at the time. How did they do it? I mean, if you don't understand the process, it looks like magic. So right now, this all looks like magic because it's much more complicated. People don't understand it, but I don't know. Will it be like magic a year from now?
So no. Practically speaking, how do you expect the field to change change the field of logistics of supply chains? To what extent can these technologies already be useful for predicting failures, for understanding what needs to be basically adjusted and so forth?
So there are many examples of this. Already, you know, The number one use of robotics is in warehouses. Warehouse robotics, robots are being, you know, installed in warehouses at a breakneck speed as we speak. Partly because there are not enough workers, and partly because it's more effective. What you're talking about, predicting failure, for example, there's the issue, it's called digital twins. It's part of AI. So what you do, you have a digital model of, let's say, an aircraft engine. So you have the aircraft engine, the physical model, the aircraft engine, and you have a digital model of the aircraft, of an aircraft engine. And the difference between a static model like we always have and a digital twin is that the aircraft engine, the real engine, always send data to the digital twin. So the aircraft goes to, I said, how many departures, how many landing, what did you go, did you have some dust in the atmosphere that went into the engine? There are a lot of sensors in the engine that automatically update the digital twin. And then you can do what if statement, and it will give you when some parts are going to fail or not fail. When do you have to replace them? Let me give you an example of digital twin that you use every day. Maybe not every day, but on the weekends. You use it and you don't even know it. But you use Google Maps?
Yes, of course.
To place. It's a digital twin, because what you have is the infrastructure on the road, the real map, and you have the digital representation of the map. The real map sends data to the digital representation all the time. Here's the congestion here, there's a, you know, go through here, go through there. So you have a digital twin on your phone or in a dashboard that's being updated from the actual system all the time. That's a classic digital twin. And it gives you, you know, action to take in the real world based on what the digital twin tells you is going on. Tell you there's a, you know, congestion along the road, so take another route, take it, whatever. Same thing happened with every other product. When you talk about predicting maintenance, predicting when you have to replace items, even your Google Map uses AI, because it uses it in order to predict what will be the congestion on the route that you are going 20 minutes from now or half an hour from now in the future. So it can give you the routing now to avoid what it thinks will happen. A lot of what AI does, AI in many ways, you can think about is a prediction engine. It predicts what will happen. When you ask ChatGPT something, it started building a sentence predicting what is the likely next word. Just probability, what's it based on all the knowledge that it is, the prediction machine. A lot of, in logistics, of course, being able to forecast better is the holy grail. If I know what people would want ahead of time, I can make sure that I have it in the warehouse, I have it in the stores, because I have to order it maybe 3 months in advance, because it takes time to make it, to collect all the stuff until it gets to me. So there's a lot of work on forecasting, lots of work on starting on risk management, on predicting failures, failure of companies, failure of items, what have you. These are some of the automation. I talk about robotic, autonomous trucks, autonomous everything that operate warehouse, operate the manufacturing plants. A lot of the more dangerous activities in manufacturing plants, in like automotive plants, things like the welding and the painting, which painting is very dangerous because its gases are really unhealthy for you, are done by robots. And this is something that the local union is okay with, because these are dangerous jobs that run the robots. So some companies very successful in installing autonomous system to do the dangerous jobs.
That makes me wonder one specific example, and kind of going back to what you were talking earlier about the difficulty of decoupling from China and from other countries. And that goes back to domestic supply chains, the fact that some of the domestic supply chains are actually partially foreign owned. And let's say you have a water supply chain or some food-related supply chain that is partially owned by a semi-hostile foreign actor like China. Can this technology predict the behavior of, could this technology be used to predict the behavior of that actor, and how they could potentially disrupt the supply chain domestically or use it in a way that's abusive or harmful in some way?
I don't think this is a big problem because every, I don't think it's a big problem because every, I mean, company, regardless of the ownership, operates in the United States, they have to operate by US laws. Just like when a company operates in China, have to operate by Chinese laws. So that's not, they cannot decide to cut it off. They cannot decide not, it's much more complicated than that. I don't think this is a big danger. And in terms of forecasting, yeah, you can, look, you're talking about intelligence gathering, basically.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it today is done with AI. Because the question is, you have millions of data points, and some of them look, they're unconnected, try to make sense out of them. People are using a lot of AI models. But this is the most sophisticated one I use by the, you know, National Security Agency, and they don't share it with me, or the CIA, and they don't share it with me. So I don't know about that.
Well, your book has put together several very separately very complicated, or at least little known concepts, which is the supply chains, AI, job creation, and future of jobs, and try to bring all of these concepts together. And given the fact that people have trouble wrapping their minds around any one of them separately, you know, tackling the subject and, you know, and bringing it to in a way that makes sense to people, that must have been very complicated. What are the big takeaways at the end of the day? What are the challenges that you foresee and the opportunities that you think are coming in light of these things, the journey of the banana and how it can be facilitated?
No, the journey of banana just explains how complex it is. But for example, once you understand supply chain, I hope people will not complain when something is not on the supermarket shelf or Amazon cannot get it in 2 days, but they'll be amazed when Amazon does it or the supermarket does it. Once they understand what it takes to do it, that's one. Second, the real message is responsibility to keep learning. People's responsibility, the technology is changing all the time, and now the change is faster than ever. So it's your responsibility to upgrade yourself. And if your company doesn't do it for you, you have to do it for yourself. As difficult as it is, find courses online, find courses in local university, whatever you can. Don't just stay on the sideline because it's dangerous. You have to make sure that you are ready for the coming technology revolution and the coming different type of job and how you work and how your job will be augmented by technology. But just understand how these things work so you'll be ready. That's all.
So I hope the same people who did not read your first book will actually, first of all, fix that mistake and read it now, because just because we had already one pandemic doesn't mean we won't have another one. Thanks. You know, people don't think that this lightning strikes the same tree twice, but I think that's not really an argument. But I also hope they also proactively read this new book, because I think it offers a lot of insights. I think it can clear up a lot of confusion and mystification around these subjects. And by the way, we're not all terrible at everything. And I'll have the cover of that actually on the flyer and on the video when it comes out. Our military excels at logistics. We've become known for successful logistic operations in Afghanistan and all these places. How do we transfer these skill sets to the civilian sector and distribute it widely among people who are not necessarily...
Actually, Actually, no. The civilian sector is, by and large, the American sector is very good at logistics. It's not that's not an issue. We know what has to be done, and by and large, look, companies like Walmart and Amazon are leaders in the world. They got to where they got because of excellent supply chain management and logistics. Because look, Walmart sells the same stuff that every other store is selling. They don't make it. They just buy it, and everybody else can buy it too. So, by the way, I don't know why my picture is suddenly fuzzy, but anyway. Ah, interesting. Okay, you look very good, and I look fuzzy. Okay, it is what it is. I don't know what's going on.
I'm glad to hear that, because I do think there is a lot of know-how to be shared internationally. Some of the disruptions that happen in other parts of the world may be preventable, and perhaps there is something to be learned, hopefully from this. I, you know, when we first started the discussion and you started listing all these things that the center does, I was shocked, because it's not that I'm not aware of any of those things separately, but I just don't necessarily think of them as something that can be learned and taught. You know, procurement or inventory, it's just, to me, it's somehow people just somehow do it and they somehow end up in those positions. I never thought of it as a learnable skill that can be transferred. And I think that in itself is something amazing, because there's so much more room for sharing and relationship building and kind of skill disbursement with these various subjects. People always think that, you know, you can do only about 10 things in life, you know, be the things that you kind of see around you, but not necessarily some of these things that happen that make everything possible. And this is just hearing it being mentioned, enumerated out loud, I think gives a lot of possibilities to people. And I think maybe we should also inform people when they're younger that these positions exist and these things can be done. I don't know if anyone grows up necessarily wanting to be a procurement expert, but at least they should know that they can be if they so choose. I just think that's a huge failure to not even inform people that they can go in that direction. And that might contribute to the skill gap that you've mentioned. People just simply don't know. They're not advised that this is something they can pursue.
Look, Irina, I need to go. This has been long.
Thank you so much for your insights. It was definitely, for me, very much paradigm shifting. And I hope the readers not only listen to this discussion, but immediately grab the book and start changing the way they think about their own lives, first of all, much less systems. For those who've been watching the program, this is the Washington Outsider Report on the Coalition Radio. And we'll be back next week, Tuesday night at 9 p.m. as usual. And thank you again to Dr. Sheffi for his time and for his insights and his book talk.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye.